Hello, my name is Leah Doyosef, and today we're going to do a lesson on the poem The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost. Let's begin with a couple of questions about you. Can you read and understand creative texts? That's a more complicated question than it sounds like, and it's built of a couple of parts. Can you understand short narratives? The setting, the characters, the plot, the themes, and other ideas that go into understanding the whole? And can you identify the overall themes of a story guided by questions and prompts? Today I'll bring the questions and prompts, and by the end of this lesson, you'll be able to say, yes, I can, to each of these questions. So here's the plan for today. We'll start with a little bit about what is poetry and why we should study it. We'll learn some new vocabulary, the background behind the poem. We'll learn about the poem itself. We'll get some basic understanding so we know the facts of the poem. We'll review that important vocabulary, and then we're going to get into a little bit of high-order thinking, compare and contrast. Let's get started. What is poetry? In order to understand what is poetry and why we should study it, we also want to know why we use language. We use our words and language to express ideas and to get other people to understand what we're thinking or feeling. So poetry is a way of expressing feelings and thoughts and ideas, conveying them to someone else through our words, through the form, through the meter and rhyme. So it's using words to evoke emotions or to place thoughts and images in the mind of the reader or the listener. I say reader or listener because poetry is generally designed to be heard more than to be read, but when we're in school, much more often we're told to read what we have in the text. So we need both of these methods of getting the text, both listening and reading, in order to really understand what's going on. So we study poetry in order to gain more understanding of how words work to pass messages from one person to another, or from one person to many. In order to use words, we need to know what they mean. So let's start looking at some vocabulary from this poem. The poem is called The Road Not Taken. And the first word I want to introduce you to is the word diverge, which means to split or separate. What you might want to do is write down any of these words that you don't know. We'll talk in a little while about how you can learn them in more effective ways. The second word is bent. It's the opposite of straight or flat, so something that has some kind of a curve in it could be called bent. Undergrowth. Imagine you've got trees growing very high, and underneath, down near the bottom, you've got small bushes and plants and grasses that are growing under the cover of those trees. And those can generally be all called undergrowth. Doubted. Doubt is when you're not really sure of something. So the form doubted could be an adjective, or it could be the past tense of the verb. Sigh. The meaning of this poem hinges on your interpretation of what a sigh is. And it's generally defined as exhaling your breath. But you can do that and go, and it could be a sigh of tiredness or relief. Or you could go, oh, wow. It could be surprise or excitement. It could be satisfaction. There are many different ways that we can sigh. And we'll get into the poem later and see exactly what you think the poet meant by sigh in this poem. Hence is a word that we use to talk about the future. As just as fair. You probably know each of these words, but together they make an expression that is comparing and saying that something's nice, just like something else. Fair can be what you might think of as fair and unfair, but it also means pretty or nice or good. It's kind of a medium level way of saying good. It's not excellent, but it's not bad either. So, as just as fair means that something's just as good as the other. A better claim, however, does have a comparative. It does have something that's got more validity to wanting to say. So a better claim says, I've got more right to this than you do. Wanted where? Something which is old and used up could be described as worn out. But something that's new could be described as wanting wear, meaning that it wants you to use it and wear it and use it up or wear it out. So it's a way of, in a backwards way, expressing newness or freshness. Trodden black. This is tricky. The word trod means to step. So if you imagine something that's fallen down, and as we walk and step on it, and it gets crushed, turns into dirt, turns black. So something which has been trodden black has turned black because people walked on it or stepped on it. Ages and ages. Age, again, by itself has many meanings. What's my age? What's your age? But when we talk about an age, we're talking about a long period of history. So ages and ages is a really long period of history. Perhaps means maybe. It's a word that shows we're not really sure. Grassy, an adjective that describes something that has grass. And a traveler is a person who goes from one place to another. Wood has multiple meanings also. It could be the material that's from trees, but it can also describe an area that has a lot of trees. Maybe not as big as a forest, maybe it is as big as a forest. It depends on the local naming, but a wood can be describing a whole area of trees. So those are some of the words that we want to learn in order to understand this poem. We've got another word that you probably know, lay. It's the past of lie. So things lay where they were, where they are. Now, how do we want to learn these words? What I suggest is that you make a Frayer square. You can see on the screen a Frayer square for the word diverge. The target word is in the middle, and around it, I have all kinds of clues that can help me to remember what the word means. The first is a definition. Diverge means to split or to separate. I have translations into my native language. I have a sentence here. They were close friends in school, but after graduation, their lives diverged. When I read this sentence, I remember what it was like in school where we were all together every day. And then afterwards, we didn't see each other every day. We each went our own ways, to our own jobs, to our own future, our own lives. So that sentence helps me remember what the word means. And I've got a picture. That's a picture of things diverging. Two lines diverged, or one line diverged into two. So the picture helps me remember. The sentence helps me remember. The translation helps me to remember. And the definition helps me. I can use this square in many ways to learn this word and be able to use it in the future. Let's look at who is Robert Frost and what was going on when he wrote this poem. Robert Frost is a poet. The word poet means that he's the person who wrote the poem. And Robert Frost himself was a poet, a farmer, and a teacher. And he lived in New Hampshire in the United States of America. And New Hampshire is an area that has lots of trees and nature and places where he could be a farmer. So when did he write the poem? He wrote this poem in 1916, and it was published in a collection of nature poems. That's over 100 years ago, and this poem is still relevant and interesting to us to read today. You might wonder how this poem has developed. We still have the same words that Robert Frost wrote over 100 years ago, but it's been widely studied and debated. Remember, I told you about that sigh. And it seems that when you read this poem, the feelings that it evokes are different depending on who you are and where you are and how you're feeling about yourself at the time when you read it. Now that's really interesting. There's a man who sat and wrote a poem, and he had an idea in his head of what he wanted the people who read it to think or feel. Now, 100 years later, we can't ask him what he meant. But each of us, when we read the poem, has a sense, a feeling of what it means to us. So that's some of the history and the development of the poem and how it's received. Let's take a look at the poem itself. I'm going to show you a video of the poem being read. And what you'll see is some of this yellow wood, the forest in the autumn.
Two roads diverged in the yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other as just as fair, having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though, as for that, the passing there had really worn them about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet, knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference.
All right, a beautiful reading of this particular poem. Let's see if we understand the basics of what's going on here. We want to know the setting. How do we know the setting? We look at the words in the poem. Yellow wood. The yellow tells us that the leaves are turning color and it must be autumn. The wood tells us it's in the forest. So we can imagine that the traveler is walking through the woods in the autumn, September, October, November maybe. There's a character, the traveler. The words, be one traveler, long I stood. Be one traveler means he's one person and he's alone. He uses the word I, which makes the reader the center of the poem. It may be a traveler, but we can all imagine ourselves as the traveler. Long I stood. I can imagine myself standing there trying to make this choice. And what's the plot of this story? Not all poems tell a story, but if you look carefully, you can often tell what it is. This I character stood at a split in the road and had to make a choice. The choice was made, it was considered, thought back on, and a prediction was made. So it isn't the same kind of action story you see in the movies, but there is a progression of things that happen in this poem. That's the basic. Now, in this poem, we had words, diverge. The two roads diverged. They were together as one and then separated. One of the roads bent in the undergrowth. So you can picture being in that forest and looking down the path, and you're looking and you can see where it curves, and finally it curves and you just see the bushes and the grasses on the side. That doubt, he made a choice and he's thinking back on it, but he doubts he'll ever get back to that choice. When you make a choice, can you ever go back and change your choice? No. By the time you've changed your mind and try to go back, you're in a different spot. So the choice is then different. So he doubts he'll ever go back. And that sigh, when you heard it, was that a sigh of relief, satisfaction, regret, or doubt? Hence, he's talking about somewhere ages and ages hence. Where's ages and ages? Sometime a long time in the future. Just as fair, those two roads were just as fair. One was nice, the other was nice. But one of them had a better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. That shows us that nobody had walked on it. We've got the leaves. The leaves had fallen fresh in the autumn, but nobody had walked on them yet. So there weren't any black leaves on the ground there. Here's ages and ages hence, a long time in the future. And perhaps is that maybe? Notice that he said perhaps it had the better claim. He's not sure which one is better. One is grassy. And the traveler is the person who needs to make that choice of which way to go and continue his travels. He's in the wood. He looks around. That's where he is, in the forest, seeing the trees. And the leaves lay on the ground, and nobody's walked on them yet. Those are the vocabulary words that we want to know. And as you're looking at the poem, if there are other words in the poem that you don't understand, go ahead and look them up. Make yourself a prayer square to remember. Now, we have two roads in this particular poem. We can compare them and contrast them. That's what the traveler does. He's looking at what's the same and what's different. This is one of the higher order thinking skills that we want to use when we analyze literature. So, one road bent in the undergrowth. I put that in one of the circles because it represents one road. Another road was grassy and wanted wear. So those are two different roads that are described differently. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. So he tells us that both roads have fresh leaves on them. So you can see in this Venn diagram, the circles that overlap is what's the same about them. When we compare and contrast, we want to use our thinking skills to look at what's the same and what's different between the two things we're comparing. Now, we're getting close to the end of this lesson, and I want you to ask those same questions. And I believe you'll find that now you feel you can read and understand a creative text. You understood this poem. We found the setting. We understood who the characters were. What's the plot? In our next lesson, we're going to get more in depth on the theme, but you probably have some ideas already. We were able to understand, and I guided you with questions and prompts. We got vocabulary, and we know what's going on in that poem. So we're going to have a break, and I want you to look over your notes, make prayer squares for the words you don't know, and think about this. Which road would you choose? You could write a paragraph comparing and contrasting to explain which road you would choose and why. I'll see you in a little while. Hello, welcome back. I'm Leah Doryosef, and today we're going to get more in depth on the poem, The Road Not Taken. In the first part of the lesson, we talked about basic understanding, and now we're going to get more in detail. Ask yourself, can you express your idea and your understanding in writing? Can you identify the whole theme of the story and plan and write a bridging text and context essay? By the time we're done with this lesson, you'll be able to say, yes, I can. What are we going to do now? We're going to talk about dilemmas and making choices. We will review the vocabulary, look at a post-reading task, and then go in depth on what is bridging text and context. Let's get started. A dilemma is a choice to make. And what makes the difference between a dilemma and a choice is that a dilemma doesn't have a clear right or wrong answer. Different points of view, different ideas, different situations can lead to different answers on this choice. And we often use the thinking skill of solving problems to work our way through a dilemma. So, what do we do with problem solving? We start with figuring out what is the dilemma or the problem. What was the traveler's dilemma? How did he solve it? What steps did he take to get there? Let's take a look. We have to start by gathering as much information as possible. The traveler stood with two roads diverging in the woods, and he had to figure out what to do, where to go. He looked down one as far as he could. He's gathering information. He weighs the option. This is perhaps the better claim. Though as for that, the passing there had warned them about the same. He's not sure. But he has to choose. I took the other as just as fair. And then he thinks back and reflects on that choice. I doubted if I should ever come back. I'll be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. So he goes through this process of gathering information, weighing the options, making a choice, and reflecting back on that choice. And that's the way to solve a problem or work through a dilemma. In this video, we're going to look at a set of birds, and I want you to ask yourselves, what are the dilemmas they face? How do they solve them? What steps do they take? I hope you'll see that they gather information, that they weigh the options and make a choice, and then they reflect on that choice. So let's take a look at what happens with the birds.
Dodgers, Hoyberg, Dodgers, Hoyberg.
So, what happened when they reflected on their choice of how to get rid of the big bird? Oops, they made a mistake. But that's okay, we all make mistakes, and when we reflect back, we learn from our mistakes. So, let's apply this to the poem, and we'll start by reviewing that vocabulary. As I go through these words, I'm going to use a sentence from the poem. Try to write your own sentence for each word. The first word is diverge. Two roads diverged. They split in the yellow wood. One road bent in the undergrowth. There was a curve in the road near the low bushes. The traveler doubted if he should ever come back. He's not sure. Thinks maybe yes, maybe no. A sigh. I shall be telling this story with a sigh. Ages and ages hence, a long time in the future. Henceforward, as we look into the future, we'll do things differently. As just as fair. The two roads were just as fair. One has a better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. Nobody had walked on that road. There were no leaves that had been stepped on and turned into black mud. Ages and ages, a long time. We can talk about things that happened ages and ages ago into the past or into the future. Perhaps, another way from maybe, perhaps this road is better than that. Perhaps it is not. One is grassy, lots of grass. What happens when you walk on the grass? It dies and turns to dirt. So if it's still grassy, nobody's walked there. The traveler, the one who goes from place to place. And the wood. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood. And I, the traveler, took the one less traveled by. Lay. You've got the verb form. Not lie to tell a lie, but lie to lie down on the ground, and lay is the past tense of that. Remember, you can build these Freyr squares. As you create the Freyr squares, you're going to be diving into what the words really mean and how you can remember them. Making sentences with the words. Make sure your sentence shows you what the word means. If you have a sentence that says, he sighed as he put the box down, it doesn't help you. He sighed with joy as he saw the sunrise. That tells you what's going on. So bring some meaning into your sentences that will help you remember what the words are. Let's review the poem itself once again. This time, I'll read it and I want you to follow along. Follow the words with your eyes. Make note of the words that you do and don't understand so you can look up the ones you don't know quite yet. This is The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth, and then took the other as just as fair and having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had worn them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day, yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh, somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. after we read a poem like this, we may, in school, have a post-reading task. And in fact, I suggest when you read poems for pleasure that you also give yourself some kind of a follow-up, something that will help you bring those ideas to life inside you. So here in the post-reading task, I want you to think of a time when you had a decision to make. Follow the pattern of the poem. When you write, I want you to introduce the dilemma. Help us, the reader, to gather as much information as possible. Show us that you're weighing the options. This is where you'll use that thinking skill, compare and contrast. What's the same about these two options? And what's different about them? And then make your choice. When you write, after you've made the choice, show us some reflection. Think about what happened because of that choice. When you're done writing this, send it to your teacher. The other writing task that you'll have when studying a poem is bridging text and context. This task uses the high-order thinking skill of making connections. You may ask, what's a bridge and the text and the context? And let's talk about that. Text is the poem itself. Context could be historical information. Remember, I told you that Robert Frost was a farmer and lived in an area that had lots of woods and trees. So this was a world that was familiar to him. That could be context. But I also told you that that sigh will depend on the context when I'm reading it, or when you're reading it. What's going on? What decisions are you facing? And how do you feel about them? Will help you interpret that context. In a test, we need to give a context that is universal or general. So it'll either be a historical piece of information or something completely separate. In fact, it's often a famous quote that follows the theme of the poem or of the story. Let's look in more detail. Bridging text and context has a specific format. The first thing you do is read the given context. On the test or from your teacher, this quote or piece of historical information will have some kind of ideas. Find that theme in the new information. Once you understand that theme, then try and find an example of that theme in the poem or in the story. And in your paragraph, when you're writing the answer, you want to explain the connection. So the bridge is that connection. What makes these two things similar? How does one inform the other? And you'll need to show the theme of the context and to show that example from the text. And these things go together to be bridging text and context. Here's an example of a famous quote that could be given to connect or to bridge to the poem, The Road Not Taken. I'll read it. In any moment of decision, the best thing you can do is the right thing. The next best thing is the wrong thing. And the worst thing you can do is nothing. This was said by Theodore Roosevelt, who was a president of the United States, ages and ages ago. And the question for you to answer in your paragraph is, how is this quote related to the poem The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost? Of course, you'll need examples. So when I read this quote, you've got a moment of decision. In the poem, we have a moment of decision. Which road should I take? In the quote, there's a right thing and a wrong thing. In the poem, we have one road and the other. Do we know which road is best? We don't know what's right and wrong. And it's clear that the traveler doesn't know what's right or wrong. But what's the worst thing you can do, according to Theodore Roosevelt? That's right, the worst thing you can do is nothing. What would happen if our traveler did nothing at that choice, standing at the place where the roads diverge and doing nothing? He'd still be sitting in the middle of the forest, not knowing where to go, and he wouldn't get anywhere. So That would be the worst thing. So you can see how I find the ideas that are in the context and connect them to the ideas and the examples that are in the text itself. So our bridging text and context puts these together. I might start with, in this quote by Theodore Roosevelt, just like in the poem The Road Not Taken, we have decisions and a choice to be made. We may or may not know what the right choice is, as in the poem where he can only see a little ways until one bends. We don't know what the wrong choice is, but we know he can't do nothing. And Theodore Roosevelt says the worst thing we could do is nothing. So we can see that this quote is connected to the poem in regard to what we need to do when we make decisions. Now, I gave you quite a few examples in that sample. You only need to give one or two in your paragraph. As you're writing, you're thinking and focused on bringing your examples from the text and from the context and pulling them together. But the moment you think you're done, I want you to go back and read your essay. When you read it the second time, ask yourself a few things. Did you answer the question as it was asked? Do you have an example from the text? Do you have an example from the context? And did you clearly show the bridge? These are the things that need to be in that paragraph. And the clue is right in the title of what we're doing. Bridge, text, context. Those are the three things you need to put. So read your essay before you really say, I'm done, and hand it in. In fact, that's good advice for anything that you write. When you finish writing, put the dot at the end of the last sentence, and before you take that big sigh, I'm done, stop and say, I'm almost done. Now you're gonna read it, and read what you wrote. Check your essay. Did you express the idea that you had in your head? Were the thoughts that you had that were so clear, probably so clear in your native language, did you get them out in paper in English? Did you use the new vocabulary, the right words from the poem, or the new ideas? Did you catch that theme? In fact, you may find that you understand the poem better now that you've built a bridge to it to something else. And perhaps, there's that maybe word, perhaps you even understand yourself a little bit better. What is that sigh? I shall be telling this with a sigh. And that has made all the difference. Does taking the road less traveled by make all the difference? Would it make a difference to you to do what others don't do? And let's think about this. Both that morning equally lay. This traveler knows the roads are really the same. So why in the future is he going to say, I took the one less traveled by? Does he really take the one less traveled by? These are some of the unknowable answers and questions in this poem that make it worth studying. We could have an argument or a discussion about the real meaning here. And as long as we use the text to base our arguments, we're both right. So ask yourself, now, can you express your understanding of the poem in writing? I'll bet you can. You can definitely identify the overall theme. You can even identify the theme of the quote. And you can plan and write that bridging text and context essay. Because in order to write that essay, you needed to understand the poem and to identify the theme and pull the examples together to put it in writing and show me or your teacher or anyone you're writing to what you were thinking. Once you feel done, all right, I wrote my essay, I finished it, and now I've read it, it really says what I wanted to, you're ready to hand in your essay. And you can say to yourself now, I understand this poem. I can express myself. Thank you. Keep up the great work and enjoy studying poetry.